couple of months ago, the Oscars, the 2013 Oscars, opened with a song that Seth MacFarlane sang. A show of hands, does this ring a bell? Did anybody here in the room see this? Maybe about half of you. Well, let me recap it for those who didn't see it. Seth MacFarlane begins singing a song.
We saw your boobs.
And the song is We Saw Your Boobs. And it's a recital of different female actors' names and the films they appeared in. And the chorus is,
In the movie that we saw, we saw your boobs.
He sings this song, and then the curtains open. It's the Los Angeles Gay Men's Chorus. They join in on the last verse. What wasn't apparent at the time was that at least four of the women actors who were named in that song lyric, their breasts appeared on screen because their characters had been raped. Jodie Foster in The Accused, her breasts were visible on screen during a flashback her character is having about the rape. And her assailants are violently ripping her breasts out of her shirt. In the movie that we saw, we saw your boobs. Hilary Swank in Boys Don't Cry. She's playing a trans man, Brandon Tina. And we see Hilary Swank's breasts. During a medical examination, after Tina's character has been brutally raped on the trunk of a car, her breasts are swollen and dark with bruises. And Hilary Swank, as the character, flinches.
In the movie that we saw, we saw your boobs.
Similarly, Halle Berry in Monsters Ball, her name was referenced in this song lyric. Charlize Theron in Monster. And I'm setting the scene this way for my topic today, which is gay male misogyny. What is it, and how do we recognize it? I'm interested to know. What distinguish it as gay male? Why does it happen, and why do gay men do it? And what does it do to others when we do it? And what does it do to ourselves when we do it? And what can we do about it? I need to preface this presentation with a bit of a warning. I'm using the word misogyny, not the more sanitized sexism. And I'm very aware that talking honestly about woman hate in a room that is predominantly male bears some similarity to talking about race hate in a room that's predominantly white, talking about gay hate in a room that's predominantly straight, because for the not male, the not white, the not straight, that conversation is very different from what it is for the male, the white, and the straight. And I want to be very careful to take that into consideration and be respectful about it, and I hope we all will be today. But we have to find ways to have those critical conversations. Now, a lot of those conversations need to take place among the, I'll call them, the targeted. That's very important. But today I want to open up a conversation about gay male misogyny that respectfully includes the targeted, but that honestly implicates the targeters. There's actually a conversation about gay male misogyny going on online. It's fairly extensive. I want to tune into it a little bit today and share with you some excerpts from some 20-something gay male bloggers who have some really interesting things to say. A young man named Ryan O'Connell, in a piece called What's the Deal with Misogynistic Gay Men, he wrote, "What frustrates me is how socially acceptable it is for gay men to treat women like crap. People assume that just because you don't want to get into a woman's pants, you're inherently a feminist. But you know what? That's not true. There are a myriad of ways to disrespect women that don't involve ploys to get them into bed. And Nico Lang, in a blog post called Gay Male Misogyny Goes Viral, College, Humor, and the War on Women's Bodies, he discusses that video called Gay Men Will Marry Your Girlfriends. Show of hands, who's seen that? It's got like 5 million hits on YouTube. It's a satire. And he writes, few have challenged its central idea that gay men have privilege over women's bodies. In a piece called Gay Men's Sexism and Women's Bodies by Yolo Akili, who is black, he writes, I was at a gay club in Atlanta with a good friend of mine who is a heterosexual black woman. While dancing in the club, a white gay male reached out and grabbed both her breasts aggressively. Shocked, she pushed him away immediately. When we both confronted him, he told us, it's no big deal. I'm gay. I don't want her. I was just having fun. We expressed our frustrations to him and demanded he apologize, but he simply refused. He clearly felt entitled to touch her body and could not even acknowledge the fact that he had assaulted her. It's very disturbing, but in a culture that doesn't see gay men who are perceived as queer as men having male privilege, our misogyny and sexist acts are instead read as diva worship or celebrating women, even when in reality they're objectification, assault, and dehumanization. It's been kind of a consensus for many decades that misogyny drives homophobia. It's kind of intuitive. I think it's kind of self-evidentially true for most people. There's not a lot of argument about that. And at the same time, gayness does not make gay men immune to the indoctrinations of this misogynistic culture. Gay men grew up in the same sexist culture as straight men. Gay men did not get a golden ticket out of it. So what, if anything, distinguishes gay male misogyny from the rest? In broad strokes, I think there are three spaces or zones where we can find misogyny. One is the intrapersonal. One is the interpersonal, the relational, and one is the political, okay? The self, the social, the structural. I submit that that last, the structural, probably doesn't have a gay male subset. If you look at the laws and other structures by which misogyny is enshrined, if you look, for instance, at the laws on marriage, the history of the laws on marriage, forced and arranged marriages, wives as property, mandatory penis and vagina sex, lawful rape in marriage, dowry, ostracism for adultery, the stigma on bastardy, which is just a way of keeping property patrilineal. If you look at that history of that particular scope of laws, it is really all a straight male patriarchal collective wet dream of a gang bang. Okay? But if you look at the first two, the dimensions of personal identity, such as relationships, interpersonal ethics, eroticism, culture, I believe there are observable gay male variants there. And I think the conversation about the particulars about gay male misogyny, it needs to happen openly and honestly. And I've got some questions that I want to just toss off in the room here to get that going. We know that homophobia originates in cultural misogyny. How are gay male identities and behaviors also shaped by cultural misogyny? This is a setup. About white supremacy, one can ask, where is there white supremacy without race hate? And about male supremacy, one can ask, where is there male supremacy without woman hate? And the answer to both questions is nowhere. So that leads me to another question on topic today. How exactly, for gay men, are male supremacy and misogyny linked, enmeshed, connected, traveling together, in bed together? For instance, how do male supremacist ideals of masculinity affect our sexual responses, desires, and sexual practices? And if we eroticize male supremacist ideals of masculinity, what is that? Are we also getting off on misogyny? Think about it for a minute. Not getting off on women, but getting off on woman hate? I don't know. I'm just asking questions. And some more. How have we internalized and sexualized the femophobia that we learned from the culture's prevailing heterosexual misogyny? How does it manifest between us, among us, and within us? What does woman hate make us hate in ourselves? I don't have answers to those questions. They're all pretty huge. They take up a lot of space in my head. Maybe they're taking up some space in yours right now. So I brought with me a diagnostic tool. It's a construct I came up with a couple years ago. And I found it very useful to explain and understand a lot of stuff. And I'm going to try it out here today to see if it helps us look at those questions in a new and useful way. I've written two books about gender. One is philosophical and one is practical. And I've condensed them into what I call a game theory of gender. Okay, it's a little simplified, but stay with me here. It's a lens for seeing stuff. It's a template in which a lot of stuff happens. It's a construct for analyzing stuff, and it's a theory I'm going to use today to try to explain and illuminate the transactional origins of gay male misogyny. It starts to happen in the real world biography of people assigned at birth to be boys, beginning even before the playground and extending well into adulthood. Imagine this is a blackboard, and I'm diagramming the rules of the game, okay? Guy one says something insulting to guy two about his masculinity, or says something threatening. I challenge you to prove your manhood. You don't seem like a real enough man to me. You're a wuss. You're a fairy. I'm going to whip your ass. You know, the drill. And if guy two buys into the game, he either has to rise to the challenge or slink away in disgrace. So, of course, guy two retaliates. And typically this escalates. So between these two guys, there's now a contest or some kind of combat with words, fists, maybe weapons. Does this look familiar so far? Does this remind you of anything from when you were five or from last week? Okay. And you know what always happens next? Either guy one wins, he proves his manhood is greater because he intimidates or injures or dominates guy two. Or else guy two wins, proves his manhood is greater because he intimidates or injures or dominates guy one. This is the transactional meaning of the manhood that every penis person grows up trying to prove. It's imprinted in sense memories he carries around, fortified with hormonal and autonomic nervous system surges. Conflict, competition, combat. And the gender identity he aspires to is always connected to his embodied memory of mano a mano combat and risky challenges from other frightening, intimidating, or dangerous males. The result is that boys grow up with a really bad case of gender anxiety. It's a universal experience of being raised to be a man. It's why boys admire invincible action heroes. They never lose. They're never feminized. But there's a third option, which neither guy one nor guy two gets hurt. It's an outcome in which both combatants prove their manhood and stay safe from each other. And what they do is this. They pick on some third party. Someone over and against whom they can jointly assert dominance. And they thereby form an alliance or a bond. The third party could be someone smaller, weaker, poorer, younger, queerer, someone whose racial, ethnic, or religious community is demeaned and despised, or simply someone female. Structurally, this master plot replicates over and over throughout boys' and young men's lives. Two humans raised to be a man, proving their manhood by putting down someone else instead of threatening and hurting each other. Any individual male can at times be a member of a bond, and at times the third party to a bond. Growing up gay doesn't exempt us from this transactional template by which manhood is forged through domination and derogation. But also, growing up gay male casts us frequently as the third party to a manhood-proving alliance. And none of us wants to be the butt of that bond ever again. But unless we have another way to think about our relation to gender, a way to rethink everything, we're pretty much going to do derogation to someone else in order to experience ourselves and be perceived as real enough men. To escape being that third party, we join in male supremacist bonds by diminishing someone else, someone female. We can do it subconsciously or consciously, overtly or covertly, on our own initiative or under peer pressure duress, one-on-one or piling on gangman style. You see? Do you see how misogyny is what gay men use to armor ourselves or inoculate ourselves against homophobia, in order to pass muster as real enough men, in order to keep from being despised by others, in order to keep from hating ourselves, in order to assuage our own gender anxiety? But given that misogyny is what drives homophobia in the first place, it's kind of a fool's game, wouldn't you say? Let's return to that scene I began with. The LA Gay Men's Chorus joining in on that song at the Oscars. Now, I don't know whose idea that was. It was Seth MacFarlane's or his writers. And I don't know whose idea it was to involve the Gay Men's Chorus. But I'm guessing that one day the phone rang and the chorus got invited to be in on the joke, which is funny the way a gay man groping a woman's breasts in a bar is funny. And you might well ask, and why was that invitation not a problem for them? Well, first, if they decline, there's no gig, no television exposure, no perks of complicity with power regimes. Poor babies. But beyond that, if these chorus boys accept, this is a huge straight gay alliance of men becoming and acting like real men. Witnessed by 4 million people, a celebration of shared manhood seen and heard around the world, the Pride Festival to end all Pride Festivals. And where do we find this move notated? On the game board of gender? Ta-da. What I like about this triangle game board is that it's an easy way for me to remember to ask some really important questions. Who's doing what to whom and why? What am I doing to whom and why? Because remember, it's a game and you don't have to play it. Remembering this triangular template helps you not fall for a goad to prove your manhood. And when someone else is enlisting your endorsement of a derogating expression or action, a misogynist one, for instance, trying to draw you into collusion with him, it helps you remember why he's looking to you for approval. He's having a gender anxiety episode. Yeah, his manhood anxiety is spiking. It's maybe off the charts. But if you think quickly, you may be able to diffuse it at no one else's expense. This will take practice and mindfulness, maybe workshops and role plays and trainings, but it can be done. And it's a lot easier to diffuse a guy's gender anxiety if you're not having an episode yourself. I mentioned earlier, we need to rethink everything. For many of us, as we have learned, feminism, especially radical feminism, kickstarts that rethink totally. And among other things, radical feminism offers a way out of the game board. When I was 29, I read something that began my own departure from the manhood game. Some of you may recognize this passage. It's from Woman Hating by Andrea. The discovery is, of course, that man and woman are fictions, caricatures, constructs. As models, they're reductive, inappropriate to human becoming. As roles, they are static, demeaning to the female, dead-ended for male and female both. It took me quite a few years after that to figure out where my identity was grounded, if not in manhood proving. And I wrote a bunch of stuff with titles like Refusing to Be a Man, The End of Manhood, Why I Stopped Trying to Be a Real Enough Man. And on the way, what started to dawn on me was that my authentic identity was with me and in me all along. It was me making moral choices, deciding on acts based on consequences and humane values, having moral agency in the world, being known to others and to myself by the content of my character. It was there all along, my moral identity. And when I paid it attention, my gender identity didn't matter so much. Contrarywise, when I paid my gender identity attention, when it was screaming for attention, when I was having a gender anxiety episode and trying to assuage it on the game board, my moral identity would go missing. It would vanish. Which could be upsetting and wounding to anyone who thought they knew me. Knew my character, knew my moral identity. John, who are you? I don't recognize you anymore. Yeah, I was being the man there. And I wasn't myself. I discovered my moral identity and my gender identity were in tension. I could flip-flop between them because they cancel each other out. But in the moment, the decision which to inhabit was always mine. I'm not saying I'm never any longer in the game. I'm saying with humility of error. I do, in fact, know where the exit is. It's where radical feminism has given us a way to think about ourselves as having a moral identity centrally and foundationally. It's where radical feminism has given a way to think about ourselves as having a social gender identity as a peripheral attribute that strangers may assume or attribute or ascribe to you, but that you no longer are driven in your interpersonal life to claim, ascertain, and maintain. Thank you.